No, it's hot. I mean, like, it's loud. It's like, yeah. What would happen, like, if God just spoke right now and said, I hear you? Would that, like, freak you out? You would start crying?
I would, like, freak out.
You would? There was a woman in church in San Bernardino years ago on a Friday night, because we had church in the bad part of town, and there were some guys that we always had weird stuff happen on a Friday night. This actually happened, and this lady was coming to our youth service, and these guys had jumped the fence, and her car was parked. The San Bernardino church is in the middle, and the parking's down the side. She parked way far away, and they had already ripped off her battery. They had jumped the fence during church, opened the hood, jimmied into her car, and took the battery out, and then closed the hood. But they wanted to come back, but we were letting out of church. There were some things they wanted to get into the trunk. And so we were leaving church, and she felt kind of weird as we were walking out. And usually I don't like, you know, someone walking that far away. And so she kept walking, and these guys were on the other side of the fence, and they were kind of looking over the fence from the end, because it was this huge piece of property to stare. Like, what is she going to do? She's going to go try and get into the car. She's going to start. And what do we do? Well, here's what's interesting. She got in the car, she turned the key, and the car started up. And she drove home. All the way home. And then the next morning, she started the car and drove all the way to church.
She didn't even know.
And these young men came to church with the battery and said, we stole this battery out of your car, and we don't know how your car started. We just wanted to return it and say, God must be.
Wow.
And they break through. When God does strange things, people, God was protecting her and blessing her. God can do stuff like that. Angels are everywhere.
Yes. Amen.
Angels are big.
Amen.
Powerful. They're not little wimps. Demons are little wimpies. Scary little things. Angels are big, bold, and powerful. Anyways, we can talk about stories. One night we'll just have to come and tell you this story. Mysterious stories we've experienced for most of the day. But without further ado, we are so blessed tonight. Why don't we stand? And we're honored to have our own Brother James Jackson with us, who has just been through a lot. Got back from Israel and then got into surgery. He was supposed to speak one of the Friday nights that we were going to have the Who Do You Think You Are series. In fact, the Friday he was supposed to talk, that was the week that he ended up going into the hospital, and he's been gone and recovering, and it doesn't look great. So I asked him to come tonight and speak to us tonight and give us what God is laying on his heart. So yeah, can we make him welcome?
As a result of being sidetracked, the Lord had an opportunity to speak to me about some things. But as I was sitting there, this song came to mind, and I don't know why it won't leave me. And it's, I love you, Lord, and I love my Lord, to worship you, my soul rejoice, enjoy my King. I don't know why, it's just that song is on my spirit.
Amen.
In what you need, let
us sweet, sweet sound in your ear. You know, the Lord has brought me through some things I'm going to tell you guys about tonight that you're going to wonder how I made it through. And there's a song, an old song saying, "How I Got Over." My soul looks back and wonder how I got over. But now I know how I got over. I started this journey 24 years ago. I may not look that old now. Now that my hair is gone, it's coming back. I'm 65 pounds lighter than I was before my illness tried to get a hold of me. But in God's infinite wisdom, He kept me.
Amen.
I was almost out of here, which I have to say, I won't complain. On the morning of when I was ill, I happened to see the Hicks, David and his dad. They were on their way to church, and I was on my way to Kaiser. Lo and behold, prior to that, a couple days prior, I really wasn't feeling well. But I attempted to push through, as most of us do, through some illness that we may have without really realizing how serious it is. But, oh, but God. God saw me through when I didn't know that I needed to be seen through. And I'm going to tell you this. When I arrived at Kaiser, I was having a little trouble prior to arriving, and that's when I saw David and his dad. They were on their way to church. That Thursday, I really wasn't feeling that hot, but I didn't really think anything of it. That Friday, so-so. Saturday, I got up, worked in the yard for about 2 hours without realizing how ill I really was. And I became very ill that Saturday afternoon. And so I put the tubes away and went and laid down. Didn't think any more of it. That Sunday morning, I got up, realizing my obligations and responsibilities, which I'm going to talk about, which is very, very, very important, especially in the house of God and anywhere for that matter. If you have responsibilities and you have people that are counting on you, you have to make sure that you're always communicating to let them know when you can what's going on. And I remember I text Kelsey and I text one or two other people. I had to briefly stop prior to getting to Kaiser. And I believe it was right around, I don't remember which street it was, when I saw you and your dad. So I had to stop. Then I continued on and I got to Kaiser. They helped me out of the vehicle. Still not realizing at this point in time how ill I actually was. I mean, deathly ill. That's how ill. Deathly. But it was the hand of God that kept me, because I should not be here right now. I should be already in glory. You know, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. So either way, it was a win-win situation. But however, going through, when I did get the Kaiser, they helped me out of the vehicle. It was around 10 o'clock, 5 after 10 that morning. 10:30, they had me prepped and ready for surgery. They said, "We're going in now." I'm like, "Well, no. Now, right now, we're going in." So I really didn't have a choice, because I was kind of fading in and out. And, you know, with some medication that they had given me. And the guy told me, when I came to, he said, you were singing some song, something about Jesus, and you were speaking in this language that I couldn't understand what you were saying. But the Spirit of the Lord was with me.
Amen.
Throughout the entire time.
Yes.
And as a result, the surgery was for about 4.5 hours. That's how bad I was. There were two surgeries. The first surgery, they had to go in and sew up a portion of my stomach. Apparently my stomach had eroded in a portion and it was dumping its portions into my body. And that's one of the reasons why I was sick. But as a result, they said, well, how did you get here? So I got in the car and drove. You drove here? Yeah. So I got insurance, you know. But no. You drove here? Yes, I drove. And it was almost unbelievable how it was done. But it was nothing but the hand of God throughout the entire time. Because when I did get over to Kaiser, I had absolutely no energy at all. I was completely lethargic by that time. So they quickly somehow got me prepared for surgery so quick, I didn't even realize that they had did it. That's how quick it was. You know, they said, we better go in. We have to go in now. And I'm like, we have to go where? No. You're going into surgery. I said, but no. You know, they gave me something, and I said, I started singing, and I started speaking in some kind of language that they say they didn't understand, but he understood.
Yes.
So throughout that point in time, I'm going to say this. There are times, like I said, I've been in this 24, actually all of my life, but in the real truth for 24 years. When you really get to the point of where, when you really get a chance to test God, really, really, really test God, there is a change that really takes place upon your life. I recall when I used to sit out and other people would talk about the experiences that they've had with God, things that have happened in their lives, how God has kept them, how God has protected them, how God has brought them through. You know, you hear that song, through many dangers, tests and trials. You really don't know what that is until you go through it. We sing it. There are a lot of songs that we sing. A lot of things that we say that you really don't understand until you actually go through it. Well, I have been transformed. I have been through something that you hear people talk about, transformation. During that time when I was in the hospital, the Lord had an opportunity to visit with me and to talk with me. And I recall on several occasions telling the Lord, I'm ready to go home. No, you're not ready yet. You're not ready. There are some things that still need to take place. But I thank God for the hand of the doctors that they were able to put me back together, should I say. Because I was kind of in a mess and I thought I was okay and they released me. I went home. Not really feeling myself, but they said, okay, you can go home. I was ready to go home after 14 days. I couldn't take it anymore in Kaiser. I just couldn't. You know, God bless them and all that they knew, but I just couldn't take it anymore. I go home. I'm at home. I'm very lethargic. No energy, didn't want to eat, couldn't eat, couldn't sleep really, not knowing all along that this problem had redeveloped, should we say. I would show you, but I'm not going to. I've already shown one of the brothers, I'm not going to. The last surgery that I had, that where I was cut from here down to here, where they opened me up. I didn't have much energy, and I happened to be talking to Brother Corey, thank God for him, on the phone. And I said, Brother, I'm really not feeling well. Could you come and get me and take me back to Kaiser? He said, sure, I'll be right there. He was there in about 15 minutes. He just happened to call me that morning. Took me back over to Kaiser. I'm there about 15 minutes. They said, you're going back in right now. I said, going back in where? I mean, I just got out of this place. After 21 days, I just couldn't take it anymore. I said, well, we're going to have to readmit you. Readmit who? They said, is there a problem with your hearing? Is there a problem with your hearing? I said, no, but no, I can't go back in the hospital. Well, why not? I just can't. No, you have to, because there's something going on. I get in, that was on a Thursday. That Friday, the surgeon, he comes into the room, you know, he's got his white coat on, and Pastor Powers happened to be there, or either he was there and Pastor Powers came. It was a very lively conversation. Brother James was not very happy when the surgeon came in and he said this to me. He says, first of all, they wanted to put this tube back down my nose, back to my stomach, and we had had some issues a couple days prior. Brother James wasn't happy about that, and he didn't mind letting them know. However, they ended up having to put it back in 2 days later. And I guess it was just a way of God's way of moving that Brother Powers was there, because I think that kind of helped control Brother James, because Brother James was just not having it. I remember Brother Powers came in and he prayed with me, and I was hoping that the surgeon would disappear. I tried my best to ignore him, and I looked and I said, you're still here? He said, yeah, I'm still here, I'm not going anywhere. But the power of he didn't say anything until the guy said to me that he wanted to put that tube back down my nose, and I looked at him, and I looked at Brother Powers, and I looked up. And I said, Lord, I don't know. I said, right now, Lord, I'm just kind of like out of my mind right now. I don't know in which direction I'm going to end up going. There were many thoughts going through my head. And thank God that he saved me many, many years ago, because if he had not, I'm quite sure I would have had some colorful words to say. I had none. I had no words to say, but I knew that I was not happy. So we finally, it was on a Friday night. I never forget, I remember Brother Powers. He had stopped by, but he had to leave because he had this class. We finally got the tube down. I wasn't happy about that. And Brother Powers left. And about 15 minutes later, the doctor comes back. And he says, you know, we're going to go into surgery this evening. And I looked at him. And I said, when? He says, right now. What do you mean, right now? He said, this is just as good a time as any. I said, oh, Lord, here you go. You know, I said, you know, for someone who loved to pray, I said, you guys are forcing me. You're really, really, I said, you know, it's too bad that I don't use them, but I don't know any curse words. I don't know any, so I can't say it. I was not very happy at all. So it took me back into surgery, another 4.5-hour surgery. And this time to correct the other side. But what I would like to say is this: through it all, God kept me. Even when I didn't know if I were to have been kept. However, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord, so it was a win-win situation. Either way, I would have won. But I would prefer to have still have been here, because I know my work here is not through. And that's one of the things that I want to talk about, that when we're faced with sudden illness, surgery, the normal thing is to ask, Lord, why? Why me? For those who believe in a living God, a loving God, there are times and events in our lives when things don't really go well. Everything that we attempt to ascribe is about God. Life may be going well for us right now, however, the thing that I find is that all those many, many, many years ago, Bible studies, prayer meetings all night long, doing visitations, doing Bible studies, God doesn't forget that. He doesn't forget that at all. The all-night prayer meetings and the going and buying the widow's food and just being busy for the Lord. He does not forget that at all. And I had gotten to the point of where I said, Lord, I don't know if I can make it. And this little quick, still, quiet voice in the back of my mind says, what do you mean you don't know if you can make it? With all things are possible. You can make it. I'm with you even until the end of the world. But my end had not come. By virtue of the fact that I'm still here, God has done a tremendous work in my life. He has allowed me to see some things and to reevaluate some things about my life and the direction that I am to go into. It was not an accident that I was led to this church. Prior to coming to this church, I did some searching and looking, and I went to a Spanish Apostolic Church. As many of you know, that I am bilingual, and I was at the Spanish Apostolic Church for about, I don't know, maybe 3 weeks. It was okay. It was over here on the other side of the park. It was okay, but it wasn't home. It didn't feel like home. There was something that was missing. Although that I know that we serve the same God, but it just wasn't a place for me. Brother, how much time do I have? But it was not a place for me. So after I found this particular church, the sanctuary, and when I walked in, there was just something about it. Yeah, I feel it. It's like home. Mm-hmm. And the only way you could say that if it's home is you have to have already been in a home before you got here to know what it's like. And so I had the opportunity to I believe Brother Faulkner may have been one of the first ones that I saw when I got here. But it was just the presence of the Lord that was here that kept me here. And we are of one body, and I think that for the most part, with my life-changing experience, because it was, of going through this year, it has changed me, and I believe that it has changed me for the better. My eyes are look at things differently. I am slow to speak. And the reason for that, it gives me an opportunity to evaluate what I'm saying as I'm saying it and before I'm saying it. Life is different for me now. I'll be 56 or 57 this month. And for many years when I was in the church, I would listen to people who had gone through something traumatic and how God has changed their lives and how He has given them a new outlook on life. About certain things, about things that I, as an individual, need to accomplish, which I am working toward. I've had an opportunity to to speak to my mother yesterday. She's 96. And she says, when you come, bring me some barbecue. So
Amen.
We give her everything she's not supposed to have, but everything she wants. At 96 years old, you can have anything you want as far as I'm concerned. So we give it to her, and the doctor, he gets a little upset with us. But we have every intention of doing that tomorrow. She will be having barbecue tomorrow, and they can deal with all of the after effects after we leave. I wish they would not be too happy, because I do receive phone calls like, why did she do this? Why did she bring that down? Well, because she wanted it. I think at 96 years old, she's an adult, and she has that right to have what she wants. You're not going to be here forever. You're not going to be here forever, but the Lord, you know, has blessed us. You know, I'm from a family of 10, as many of you may know or may not know. There are 10 of us, 5 girls and 5 boys. A couple of them have already gone home to be with the Lord. Thank the Lord. My mom is still here. My dad went home to be with the Lord 13 years ago. But we're still keeping on, because we still have a mission in life that we must complete. And I do have about 40 nephews and nieces, and there's a whole bunch of us. But the Lord has blessed this family. You know, my parents, they were married for 63 years, which is a rarity these days. But they were, and after 10 kids later, I'm a product of one of those 10. And the Lord has blessed us as a family. All the kids are saved. Thank the Lord for that. It took some a little longer than others. But we are all here now. When I was going through the turmoil that I was going through, I had a question, and it was to the Lord, why me? Why am I'm faced with this life-changing experience? And sometimes in life, the Lord has to get our attention. One way or another, He's going to get your attention. One way or another. They said, well, Brother James, what did you do to deserve this? Nothing. You're just a part of life. You know? Body's getting older. 56, 57 is this month, whatever. I don't know. I've lost count. But I think that the Lord has blessed. I have no complaints. I have to say that throughout these many years of serving the Lord, I've seen a lot. Yes, I've seen a lot. I've seen the Lord bless. I've seen the Lord give. I've seen the Lord take away. I've seen the Lord correct when a correction was needed. But through it all, I've never gave up for His love and His trust. And I'd like to really speak to the young men. In this life, you're going to face many, many, many challenges. Many challenges. Possibility of a few more than I. Because as things change. But I want to encourage you to hold on to your confession of faith, because you have nothing else. Anything outside of this is an illusion. And if you don't think it's an illusion, just keep living. And you will realize that, oh man, I shouldn't have done that. Oh man, I shouldn't have said that. Heed to the counsel that's given to you by a godly person. Not just any person, because that's important as well. Because the enemy, he has a way of creating a deception. Stay in the body. Stay in the body. Do not leave the body of Christ. Again, I repeat, do not leave the body under any circumstance. Under any circumstance. When you're under a man of God, you've got people that love you and that care for you. The enemy will attempt to show you something or give you something or say, well, this is better, you never had this before. Don't fall for it. Don't fall for it. I had a loving mother, still have a loving mother, who prayed for me and my four brothers. Because I tell you, as they used to say, I don't know if anyone uses these words anymore, but it's called, you talk about rascals. Remember that show, The Little Rascals? Oh, we were the little rascals. I mean, I couldn't go one day, not one day, without getting a whipping. Not one day. My whipping had my name on it. Not one day could I go. If I didn't, something was wrong. I just had to have that touch of the leather. And moms didn't mind providing that touch, that needed touch. You know, when you have brothers, as I do, mother became very inventive. One of my brothers, he was so bad, she put him in a croaker sack. I don't know if anyone knows what a croaker sack is. Probably the pastor, you know, he knows what that is. A croaker sack is a sack where they put potatoes. You know, it's kind of like a weave type bag. Well, he had an opportunity to meet fire in one of those bags. I'm telling you, mom had to be creative. Had to be creative because she had five boys and five girls. But the boys, you know, the girls are not a problem. It's always us boys. We get into stuff, we do things, you know. We go places we're not supposed to go, you know, until someone sees you. I'm going to tell your mother. I know your mother, and that was my case. We were from a little country town. That's the Jackson boy. I'm calling your mother right now. And so when you got home, it was waiting for you. And if it wasn't waiting for you, it would be soon, you know? And I was very mischief, stayed in a lot, got in a lot of trouble. But through it all, God kept me. God kept me. Because if he had not had kept me, I wouldn't be here today. I would not have the opportunity to speak to you guys today. To let you know, God is good, God is real. Amen. And if anyone tells you the contrary, well, send them my way. I think that I could have a conversation with them. Brother James used to be real quick with the fist. Really quick. I mean, before you knew it, you were down. That's how quick I was. But when the Lord, when the Lord gets a hold of you, he has a way of transforming you and putting your heart to a place where it needs to be. And you now fight for him instead of just fighting. Oh, I used to love to fight, you know, there was nothing better than fighting, you know. And you wanted to fight, just say, hey, we'd go out back and we would get it, you know. But the Lord has changed all of that. You know, he's given me a brand new heart. A heart for souls, and the ability to love people where they are, and to bring them to the place of where they need to be. Because people, I'm telling you, this is real. This life that we live, it is real. It is real, and it is, we have an obligation to share with others this life that we have received. You remember when you first got saved? Oh, everybody you saw. Oh, you wanted to tell everybody you saw. Oh, you couldn't be quiet. Oh, every time you talk to somebody, you know, oh, here he comes again, that Bible-thumping boy. You know, but that's okay, you know. But when things happen, they would come and say, hey, brother, can you pray for me? Ooh, hey, now, you know, the Lord, he always opens up a door for you. But we have to be at a point of where we are, the Bible says, be always ready. Always ready to give any man and every man an answer for the hope that lies within you, because you will be tested. You will be tested. You know, and I do thank Brother Powers and You know, I love everyone here at the church, and I'm still recovering, but I thank God I am not where I was 8 weeks ago.
Amen.
Because I was on my way out. I mean, which would have been okay to be absent from the bodies to be present with the Lord. You know, it was a win-win situation for me, but my work here had not completed. There's still much for me to do, and I'm very much up for the challenge. Now I can run this race that's been set before me, so now I don't have anything holding me back.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen.